Okay, so after hearing things in that silence, such as technical failure, disaster, and so forth, now I'm just going to try to provide a couple of diverse examples of hearing things and sounds. So cases where the same acoustic stimulus, you might say, is heard and experienced in very different ways. And the first example that I'm going to present comes from really a failed pedagogical effort where, so every fall semester I teach this colloquium that's about music cognition, and I really wanted the students in the room to have a sense of how complicated it was going to be to try to construct an empirical science out of something that was so subjective and where responses were so different and varied from person to person. So I would play them a piece, and I tell them beforehand that they could write down anything about their experience during the course of this excerpt, and so it's really trying to push them in a direction where what they would say was, you know, very different from person to person, and then we'd say, okay, look how complex this is going to be, to try to think about this empirically. And semester after semester, the music would stop, and they would say, raise their hand and say something about pirates. You know, I think it took many semesters before I could truly believe the extent to which piracy was embedded in the sounds I was playing for them, and to actually try to look at this phenomenon in my own research. So now I'm going to play you just a brief clip of an excerpt of 19th century music and tell you a little bit about how people responded to this in a study setting. To do a lot of things, and one of the things they were asked to do was say whether that they had experienced any kind of associated story while they were listening. So this is part of a larger project having to do with people's narrative kinds of perceptions of music, and the free response part should be quite difficult to deal with. And so when I started looking through people's responses and saw levels of consensus that were around for many excerpts, three-fourths of participants or larger having consensus about the content that they were associating with the sound. So in this case, and I can just assure you, this is an example of how time and place can really change things, pretty sure that there is no cat and mouse on Liszt's mind when he was composing this portion of the Faust symphony, which is marked Mephistopheles. It's different. And so description after description had featured cats and mice, and even when it seemed like the participant was bringing something new to the hearing, so this music reminded me of the movie Cinderella, specifically the scene where the mice are running away from the big fluffy cat. found a way to inject this cat mouse iconography. Okay, let's think about one other example here. Okay, free responses for this one showed even higher consensus, and the words that came up most frequently in these descriptions were fancy ballroom, not only a fancy ballroom, but also a fancy ballroom set sometime in the past. So the exact time point varied from the time of Romeo and Juliet to 18th century to medieval times. So there was not agreement about exactly when, but it was clear that